Hi guys, it's great to see you again. Today we're going to deep dive into a tool that is controversial amongst colorists and everybody seems to have an opinion about it. HSL Qualifier. You may have already come across tons of discussions about why qualifiers are bad and whether you should use them at all. And if you do need to use them, then what are the best techniques? So I'm going to do my best to cover all of the concerns and some of the bad practices I've seen online, and then I'm going to show you ways to use qualifiers in clean, non-destructive ways. So without further ado, let's dive in.
What is an HSL qualifier? Before we jump into Resolve, let's ensure we fully understand how the HSL qualifier works and what you may need it for. Firstly, we have hue, which essentially stands for the color we'd like to isolate. Saturation is referring to how saturated that color is, with low saturation levels sitting on the left and highly saturated levels being on the right. And finally, luminance essentially stands for how dark or bright the color is. And on the right side of the panel, we have some tools that allow us to refine our selection. So the HSL qualifier is a tool meant for secondary corrections. These are more narrow, focused adjustments to specific things in your image. And so to put this into context, let's take this shot of three hockey players as an example. A secondary adjustment here would be if we decided to isolate their red helmets and make them denser. Another example of a secondary would be if we created a power window around their faces and added a bit more exposure. So any local and more targeted hue, saturation, and luminance changes are what we call secondaries. Naturally, the opposite is what we call primary adjustments. So for example, adjusting the overall exposure, temp and tint, contrast changes, and tonal changes applied to the entire image in broad strokes are primary adjustments. And the tools you may use for those are primaries, log wheels, HDR wheels, or custom curves. So why are qualifiers specifically considered to be bad then?
Well, there are a number of concerns you may want to consider before reaching for this tool.
If you've ever tried to pull a key, then you know that often it can be really difficult and time-consuming to get a clean selection. And even when you have a good selection, you may need to restrict it further with a power window. But the shot isn't static, so now you need to track your power window. And before you realize it, you've spent 15 minutes on a single correction. But what's worse is that if you try to copy across your key to the next shot, 9 times out of 10, you're going to have to adjust the key to make it work. And so you can see how this can be problematic and incredibly time consuming.
Therefore, using qualifiers when they're not absolutely essential is seen as inefficient and amateur. Now that we understand some of the concerns associated with this tool, I'd like to go over a few bad practices I've come across online and explain what's problematic about them.
Bad practice number one, skin qualifier, an outside node.
This is a technique I've seen being demonstrated on YouTube, typically in the context of creating a complementary teal and orange color scheme.
So let's say we want to create a better color separation between our talent and the background. And this underground location lends itself to a teal and orange look. So I can pull a qualifier on the skin tones to isolate them. Let me grab the color picker and start dragging it over her skin. Now, if I toggle highlight mode on, I can see what's being selected, and I'm going to do my best to refine the key with some blur and feathering to the hue, saturation, and luminance ranges. Now that I have a decent key of the skin, if I create an outside node, I can make changes to everything else and the skin tones will stay neutral and intact. So if we start introducing some cool tones with gamma or gain, we can see how we're getting a complementary color scheme and we can confirm this on the vectorscope as well. So why is this a bad approach? Well, for a number of reasons. Firstly, as we said, the HSL qualifier is meant for secondary adjustments, not look development. And even though it may seem that this works well on a single shot, as soon as we try to ripple this grade across multiple shots, we're going to see how quickly this key is going to fall apart. So overall, this isn't a clean way to work.
You want to achieve your looks with broad strokes, and then, if needed and if you have time, move on to secondary, more narrow adjustments.
Bad practice number two, incorrect order of operations.
Another caveat to take into consideration when using qualifiers is to ensure that your order of operations is correct.
Before getting into any secondaries, you want to make sure that you have set your exposure and white balance correctly so that you have a good color separation in your image. Let me mock up a scenario where the same shot is unbalanced and slightly underexposed, and let's imagine that this is how it came to us. So I'm going to cool off the temperature and drop down exposure using my HDR global wheel. And then I'm going to create a new serial node. Now, if we try to pull a selection on the skin the way we just did a moment ago, you'll see that it's impossible to get a clean key. And the reason is that we no longer have a good color separation in our image, and so the qualifier is struggling to make out any differentiation between the skin and the background. Next up, moving on to bad practice number 3, using qualifiers for 8-bit Rec. 709 footage. If you've ever tried to use the HSL qualifier on 8-bit normalized footage, then you've seen it's mission impossible to get a clean selection without any chatter or artifacting. And the reason why this happens is because the dynamic range of 8-bit Rec. 709 footage is very limited. And to understand just how tiny it is, here is a comparison between Rec. 709 and Arri Log C3 on a CIE chromaticity diagram. As you can see, Arri's logarithmic color space is more than 50% bigger than the limited gamut of Rec. 709. And what this means in the context of qualifiers is that when you're working with footage filmed in log or raw, you have enough dynamic range to do more complex operations such as pulling keys or removing green screen, for example.
So as a general rule of thumb, you want to be gentle with your corrections when you're working with 8-bit images. I think we've covered plenty of no-nos now, so let's move on to a technique that won't break your images.
Good practice number 1, broad single qualifier. If you try limiting your use to a single domain of the HSL qualifier, so for example, just the saturation or luminance section, you're going to notice that the results are going to be much cleaner. Here are a couple of scenarios to consider. In this image, I think that the yellow jacket in the background is too saturated and is pulling my attention away from the talent in the foreground. So to address this, I can use the saturation section of the HSL qualifier and start creating a selection of the highly saturated areas. So I'll start increasing the low threshold and I'll add a good level of feathering with low soft to ensure that the transition between what is being affected and what isn't is really broad and soft. Now, I can simply decrease saturation in my primaries down here. Since this is a broad key with a lot of feathering based on a single domain, saturation, I'm confident that it will not break my image, and it could even be a part of my look development stack as a way to bring down highly saturated areas on a global level. Here is another image that I think could use a decrease of brightness in the sky as it feels too hot currently for a sunset scene. So what I can do is use the luminance section of my HSL qualifier to select the bright areas I want to affect. I'll start cutting off dark areas of my image with low and add a good amount of softness in the selection with low soft. Now I can use highlights in my primaries to bring down the brightness in this area. Again, since this is a key based on a single domain, luminance, and we've added a lot of feathering to it, I'm more than confident it's not going to break my image. In fact, I have a preseted Luma key just like this one embedded as one of the first nodes in my fixed node tree, and I use it all the time. Now let's move on to good practice number 2, combining power windows and HSL adjustment.
So this isn't a qualifier technique, but it's rather a workaround to achieve similar results with different tools.
Let's go back to the very first clip of the hockey players we looked at and attempt to do the same adjustment to their helmets. So if you remember, we wanted to make their helmets more dense so we get those beautiful film-like reds. What we can do is restrict the selection by drawing power windows around their helmets so that any changes made to the reds don't also affect their lips and hockey sticks. Now we can use an array of tools to get the exact hue we want. We can try hue versus luminance by selecting the red vector and pulling it down to decrease its luminance. Color slice is another great tool which is entirely dedicated to density. Or we can also achieve a similar result with color warper in HSV color model. Personally, I use these alternatives to the qualifier all the time.
There is nothing revolutionary about this technique, but as there are multiple ways to do things in Resolve, I'd like you to always take the time and think, alright, which tool is going to get me a clean result efficiently? And I think you're going to find that 9 times out of 10, the HSL qualifier is not the answer. And this wraps it up for today. As always, I'm keen to hear if you have any cool techniques as an alternative to the qualifier. If so, let me know in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, please like and consider subscribing to the channel. Thank you so much, and I'll see you in the next one.